God bless you, my brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Professional Truckers Association Church. I do count it a privilege each week to stand before you and minister the Word of God. I want you to know that I love the Lord with all my heart, and I love you, my brothers and sisters, and doing all that I can to impart God's Word to you. I ask that you pray for me daily, and that God will word my mouth and anoint me for His service. And I also pray for this church, the Professional Truckers Association Church, and our truck driving brothers and sisters all over the world. We want you to know that we do love you, and we stand here in sincerity trying to be a help to you. I also want you to know it would be beneficial to you to go to the Professional Truckers Association website and see all that they have for you there. I do have friends there. Brother Ernie works day and night and doing all that he can to supply all the needs for the truckers in a way that they can get them without having to go too far out their way. And I do thank God for you. Thank God for Brother Ernie and this organization. I think it's helping a lot of truck drivers. I also thank God for them allowing me to see to the spiritual needs of the truck drivers. I want you to know I am here for you. I pray for you daily, and I ask God to help you. If you need me for any reason, please listen to the conclusion of this session. Our contact information will be given. If you write me or contact me via the World Wide Web, I will respond and do all that I can to be the pastor that you need in this day and this time. Well, we're going to have a word of prayer, and after we have prayed, we're going to a passage of Scripture and see what we can get out of God's Word. If you would bow your heads with me as we pray, if it is expedient for you, if you are driving, I do understand, listen to us and pray in your heart that God will get the glory out of all that we do. Father God, I just want to thank you for another day that you have kept us. Thank you, Lord, because you are so good and you're so wonderful to us. I thank you for my health and strength and the health and strength of my brothers and sisters. I ask that you be with us, Lord, every day of our lives. Be a protection around us. All of my truck driver friends as they travel up and down the highways, and all of our friends and members of this church, I do want to thank God for all of them. All of them are not truck drivers, and I want you to smile on all of us. Smile on the truck driving community and smile on my brothers and sisters just tune in and like what we have to say and stay. Thank God for them, Lord. I ask that you give us health, good health, and strengthen our bodies and keep us holy and keep us righteous under you and help us to do thy will, and we will give your name the praise for all things. Keep us safe as we drive over the highways. Don't let the devil make us have accidents. And Lord, even protect our families back at home. While we're away, I want you to be with the families and keep the family unit together. And we will give your name the praise for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, we're going to read a couple of passages of Scripture today. We're going to read the very last chapter in the book of St. Luke, chapter 24 and verse 45, and see what we can get out of that chapter. We will put emphasis around verse 49, and then we will go from there to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, and see what we can get from God's Word today. I want you to know that I'm doing all I can to give you the truth in God's Word. I want you to be overcoming Christians, and I want you to love the Lord with all your heart, as I do. Well, verse 45 of chapter 24, Luke's Gospel, it reads as this: Then opened he their understandings, that they might understand the Scripture. You have to understand a lot of things that transpired, and a lot of things they didn't grasp when Jesus was talking to them before he was resurrected. You have to understand he showed himself alive to his disciples and many other people. They saw him alive after he was crucified and after he was resurrected, after these things had transpired. You got to understand, a lot of times we miss the message when it's so close to us. Well, Jesus opened up their understanding after he'd been resurrected, and he talked to them. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scripture. And this is what it's all about, babies. It's all about understanding the scriptures. My brothers and sisters, please don't be offended that in my Word with Chester Ministries, I use the term my dears or babies or something of that nature. I would not insult my truck driver friends to try to make you think you're smaller or whatever than you are. You're my brothers and sisters, and I love you with the love of the Lord. I will get the correct terminology here. Then open he their understand that they might understand the scripture. Dear ones, brothers, sisters, whatever you want me to call you. Well, it's all about understanding the scripture. It's not about anything else but knowing what the scripture says. That's the word of God. Many of us have ideas and ideologies, and the organized church have things, the way they think about things, and the unorganized church have a way they think about things, but it's all about the scripture. If you can grasp and understand the scripture, and this is what Jesus wanted to do, help them to understand the scripture. In verse 46, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooves Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. In other words, this was a necessity. If you read in scripture everything that the scripture had to say about it, you have to understand this is all being fulfilled. What is Jesus talking about? The Old Testament scripture. He was making plain to them everything that had transpired. In verse 47, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Get that picture. Explain to them, let me read 46 and then 47, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooves Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. How important it is for you to know that, that Jesus just didn't die and lay there, but he rose from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Well, what should be preached? Repentance. And all repentance is just turn around. Turn around, you're going the wrong direction. If you're going the wrong direction on the interstate, what do? You get off the next off-ramp and turn around, go back the other direction. That's what repentance is. If you're going the wrong direction, just turn around. And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name. Repentance and remission. Well, forgiveness, you got to understand. It's not just you just turning around, going the other direction. Well, that's important for you to turn around and go the other direction. But that remission, well, your forgiveness. You got to understand, when you turn around, your sins are forgiven. Many people walk around in condemnation. They may not even do the things that they used to do prior. But you got to understand, if they're yet walking in condemnation, they don't have the full message, yet. And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached. Repentance and remission or forgiveness, all of these things. You got to, number one, turn around. But number two, you need to know that you're forgiven for your sins. That's the reason Jesus came, and that's the reason he died, so that you could be forgiven for your sins. Not only you, but me and all of us, we could be forgiven for our sins. So don't let the devil keep you in condemnation. Just repent of your sins and turn around. Go the right direction. Ask God to forgive you and know that your sins are forgiven. They are remitted. The remission of sin, the forgiveness of sin. Jesus paid the price for your sin, so you didn't have to pay it. Well, get that picture, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations. Not just some nation, but all nations. Beginning at Jerusalem. Well, let's read on in verse 48. And ye are witnesses of these things. You're witnesses of these things. Well, one more verse here. Well, I may read a few more. Verse 49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. What's the promise of his Father? Well, the gift of the Holy Ghost. That's what he's talking about. The gift of the Holy Ghost. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. Well, I'm going to send the promise of my Father. This is what Jesus is saying. But you tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. In other words, you stay there at Jerusalem. Tarry means to wait. Wait there in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. Well, this is one of the mistakes that we make of in Christendom. Many times we don't wait on the gift of the Holy Ghost. Somebody say, well, it's there. Well, God is omnipresent, present. Yes, he is. All those things are true. And I would not knock that. Somebody say, well, I got the Holy Spirit when I received salvation and all these things. Well, I do understand. All the Holy Spirit deals with us even at the time when we are saved. It takes the Holy Ghost to convict us of our sin for us to turn around. All this is the Holy Ghost. But yet, so many people, they don't wait until they're endued with power from on high. Well, you're talking about the power of the Holy Ghost. Many people know about the Holy Ghost, but they don't know about the power of the Holy Ghost, and they haven't waited until this manifestation of the Holy Ghost has started to operate in them. I hope you understand me. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Wait there in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high, until the power of the Holy Ghost come upon you. Wait there for it. And let me let you know, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you're going to know it. When the Holy Spirit has endowed you with power, you're going to know it. When you have been endued with the power of the Holy Ghost, you're going to know it. But Jesus said, wait there until you know this now. Wait there until you have been endued with the power from on high. Well, let's continue reading. And he led them out as far as Bethany, and he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple praising and blessing God. Amen. Well, that's the words, and the author there is Brother Luke, that beloved physician. That beloved physician. Well, get that picture. After he told these things, they went to Jerusalem. And this same writer, the physician, Brother Luke, wrote on. You got to understand, he wrote the book, the Gospel of St. Luke. Also, he wrote the Acts of the Apostles. And the disciples did as Jesus had instructed them, to go to Jerusalem and wait there until you be endowed or be endued with power from on high. You got to understand, they went and they were praising and magnifying God daily in the temple. There at Jerusalem, they were there. Yes, they got sidetracked and had to take care of a little bit of carnal business. Peter thought that he had to, true enough, it was written in Scripture that someone would place Judas Iscariot, and they cast lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias. You know the Scripture, you can read it for yourself. And after they got all of this business out of the way, they were there in the upper room, and they were praising and blessing and magnifying God. And this is what I want you to get to today. Well, you need to to sometimes just break away from what we know as society. Get off somewhere and begin to praise and begin to magnify God. Let me let you know something will happen in your life. It's no secret. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. All you have to do is give vent to Him and yield yourself to Him. Begin to praise and magnify Him. Things will happen in your life. They were there in Jerusalem, and they did as Jesus had told them. And there in Jerusalem, in the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, verse 1, but when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were there with one accord, and they were all praising and magnifying God. Don't you know we need to get to that point again today? We need to get with one accord and start praising and magnifying God. We don't went way off in left field somewhere now, and we've lost the real praise to God. We started seeing who can sing the best and seeing who can who's got the best choir and all this kind of stuff. All that's all right, you. I'm not knocking things and knocking the situation, but I want you to know we really need to start praising God, magnifying the true and the living God. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues as a fire, and it set upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They were there in the upper room, and something began to happen. When they got their mind channeled on praising God, when they got their mind in tune and with one accord, all thinking about the same thing, all praising and magnifying the true and the living God, the Holy Ghost came upon them. What are you talking about? Shall I read it again? When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongue as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They began to speak in a tongue unknown to what to themselves. Now, we've covered this in an earlier lesson in our teaching on the Holy Ghost. They began to speak in a tongue unknown to themselves. Well, it wasn't per se so much for them, and then it was for them. What are you talking about? For them or not so much for them? It was for them because this was new to them. This language that they were speaking that came upon them, and they were speaking in an a tongue unknown to themselves. And then what we talked about, the other people in Jerusalem there, devout men out of every nation, they heard them speak in their own tongue. So this was a miracle. What are you talking about? These men had not went to different schools to learn different languages. They were not privy to all the languages that were of the nationalities of people that visited Jerusalem. Well, God was in it, and they knew that the Spirit of God was in this when they began to speak in other tongues unknown to themselves. Well, I am not trying to tell you that speaking in tongues, if you don't speak in tongues, you're not saved. I'm not here to tell you all that kind of stuff. I'm here to tell you that the power of God is real. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is real. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you, it'll have you doing things that you can't do. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you and overshadows you, it takes you above yourself. It takes you above your own intellect, and you will be doing things, saying things. Things will be happening in and through you that you by yourself and of yourself would not be able to do. Why? Because the Holy Ghost is real. And I challenge you, my brothers and sisters, seek God for the fullness of the Holy Ghost. If you don't understand it, just ask Him, Lord, fill me with Your Spirit. Fill me with Your Holy Ghost. And I challenge you, just start praising Him and magnifying magnified, and the Holy Spirit will come upon you. We need him in our churches. We need the real gift of the Holy Ghost back in our churches, where the Holy Ghost moved, and it's not about entertainment. It's not about how I dress when I go to church, but I'm seeking the true and the living God. And when the Holy Spirit comes in, it will overshadow me and those that are there with me. And it will do things to us and through us that we have never done before. Why? Because the Holy Ghost is real. I challenge you, my friends, my brothers and sisters, seek God for the Holy Ghost. It's yet real. This was not just something that in the apostles' day that God brought the Holy Ghost and filled them with the Holy Ghost. Well, it's for all believers. Jesus said, "These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name, they'll speak with new tongues," and so forth on down the line. "They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." All of these things are for the believers. That was the believers in that day, and also for the believers in the day that we live. Why? Because the Holy Ghost is real, the Holy Ghost is present, and all he wants is for us to yield ourselves to him and let him show up and act up in our lives. It's not just for you, the believer, but for those on the outside when they see the miracle working power of Jesus. Now, you got to understand, I'm a believer, and I believe in Jesus. If I see nothing happen, I know he's real. If I don't see any, you got to understand, if I don't take one more breath, I know that Jesus is real, and I'm going to rest in his everlasting arm. But the ones on the outside, when they see the Holy Ghost move, when they see the power of the Holy Ghost operating in the believers, they'll see and they'll know that this thing is real. And they'll come to Jesus. They'll come to Jesus. You got to understand, they won't only come to church, but they'll come to Jesus. A whole lot of folks come to church, but don't come to Jesus. They come to hear the songs. They come to hear the great choir. They come to hear that man speak with that elegant voice that can place his words. And they feel, you know, it makes them feel good about themselves. You got to understand, the Holy Ghost is much more than that. When we see him in the reality that he is, when the world sees him in the reality that he is, they won't only come to church, they'll come to Jesus. And when they come to Jesus, they will no longer be the same. Well, my brothers and sisters, I do want you to know that I love you with the love of the Lord. If you would like to contact me for any reason, you can write me at the Word with Chester Ministries. You can reach me as pastor of the Professional Truckers Association Church. You can reach me, but you can write Post Office Box 200603, San Antonio, Texas, 78220. You can also reach me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Remember, my brothers and sisters, I love you. I love you with the love of the Lord. God bless you.